more important. Sometimes patients and a patient attendant, what they say, so tell so many stories. But we need what we need for our history and what for the diagnosis. So evaluate is more important. And if you have any doubt, you inquire about that evaluation. So any symptoms we want to probe further. And most important in psychiatry is observations. This is the only clinical sign. So this is the observations is more important in psychiatry. And as a whole, we understand the patient. So these are the five vowels. We always remember: audations, evaluations, inquiry, observation, and understanding. This is an important clinical skill for any interview techniques. And psychiatric interview, we have already pointed out there are certain details to be there, identifying data, present problem. And this is the usual technique we have followed: history of personal illness, past, and everything we have to follow. But in details, first and identifying data. So this is more important in psychiatry. Even it's not only statistical analysis. If you call by the name of the patients, it's how developing a rapport. So if call by Venkatesh, if I am happy rather than calling Mr. X or Y. So call of the name of the patients is more important. So remember every patient's name preferably. And sometimes certain disorders are more prone to develop certain ages and certain sexes. So these itself give you a clue to a diagnosis. So for example, a person with 70 years come with psychiatric problem, always think of some other something have some important. In identifying data, not only we collect the person's information, we also collect the informant information. Not only the person's information, another important in psychiatry, we need the reliable informant. Sometimes, generally, we always ask the parents to come. But instead of, we always need a reliable informant who present at the time of psychopathology. For example, a person staying in a hostel along with their friend, taking cannabis, cannot be given by the history by the parent. So the reliable informant is always present during the psychopathology of the patient. So that is a reliable informant. So that also needed in our identifying data. And how to write your complaints. There's a lot of confusion even now. Even if I am a PG student, I am cannot able to write a proper complaints. So first and foremost, the complaints should be in the patient's own verbatim. Don't write hallucinations or delusions like that. Always what the patient says is the patient's own verbatim is more important. And second important is the chronological orders, how the symptoms started, when it started and how long to be there. This is the second importance of chronological order. And third one is important, the symptom clusters. Sometimes in psychiatry, we have to divide so many ways to divide the complaints in a biological and non-biological, behavioral, affect, tonation, and cognitions. But usually how to write in a biological symptom and non-biological and behavioral symptoms. This is very easy to say that. Otherwise, usually we don't write hallucination and delusion in the complaints, preferably like sleep disturbances, appetite loss, anger outburst, and disinhibitions, not doing household activity. So these are the simple symptoms you have right in this chronological orders. And onset, I already told, it's an acute or in chronic or in serious onset. According to ICD-10, onset to be always acute. That means it's between 1 month. After 1 month, we call it a subacute or chronic onset. The acute onset, that means all the symptoms have developed and reach a peak within a short span of period. That is called as an acute onset. So this is more important because always acute onset, we have to identify some stressors. So precipitation of the illness. But this is the another important point. Always stressor, you cannot say that sometimes a casual causative relations to be there. So every person, you cannot identify sometimes stressor. But preferably in acute onset, you identify a stressor and how the progress of the illness. It's a static post or sometimes deteriorating or sometimes it's become lessened. So these are the points you have to write in the chief complaints. And coming to the history of personal illness. History of personal illness means there's only elaboration of the complaints. That is more important. So you have to elaborate the complaints what you have made in the chief complaints. So that we have to remember certain seven integratives. What that are seven important, everybody knows that. The what. What means the description of the symptoms in detail. It's how to say that adjectives and everything, how to put in that. How the symptoms are worsen or is aggravated or all the things are come into the what. And when we know that is the temporal futures associated with the symptoms. When it started and how long is the durations and how is the intensity and frequency of the symptoms. And where is always know that where the symptoms is a spatial and geographic relations to the symptoms. and which is associated symptoms. So I have the vitamins. If associated other symptoms, morning high, how I look that, are the symptom associated symptoms very important in that, and who, whether always we know that interpersonal to the problem to whom is more important, and why always we know that the precipitating events. So these are the seven integrated symptoms you elaborate in history of personalness of every patient. So if you outwrite these things, your history of personalness become elaborate, because we not a what is important in long histories, we have adequate time. If you have a history of personalness very short, the examiner will take over. So we have to write an elaborate history like a story. And not only history of personalness, only the complaints or the positive symptoms, always also included important negative symptoms what we have. So for example, if a patient has depression, we have to write the negative symptom of manic symptoms. So these are important. And another important certain things are common to every history of personalness that already pointed out, suicide and homicides. So these are more important in psychiatry. So without these suicide and homicides, we cannot history of personalness is completed. And substance abuse. The substance abuse sometimes may be a separate long questions, but at least we have to write the pattern of drinking. Every case sheet you have to write the pattern of drinking and what the current pattern of drinking, something binge drinking and some like that. And withdrawal symptom always be noted, and in the psychological and physical complication of substance and socioeconomic situation. So these are the four at least minimum headings to write in every person's with history of personalness. And we know that legal histories, suppose the person is legal histories, is always careful before writing the case sheets, because sometimes it's malingering also. So every differential diagnosis we think of malingering if there is a legal case history is present with the patient. So legal history and head injury, everybody know. But epilepsy is in epilepsy psychiatry, for every differential diagnosis we can put as an epilepsy diagnosis. For example, is anxiety, something prodromal symptom of epilepsy may present as anxiety symptoms, ictal symptoms. So every differential diagnosis, epilepsy is one of the DD. So we have to always inquire about detail of the epilepsy. And epilepsy always, we don't think only the seizures, general tonic-clonic fits. Always remember that there are some complex partial seizure. There are only sometimes absent seizures like, so they are only staring off look or only lip smacking or automatism. So always remember epilepsy, every headings of epilepsy always remember. And coming to that though, these are the, so these up to this, we have to write the history of personalness. And coming to the past histories, past history always you have to, it's an episodic illness. If you have to know the same episodes in previous illness or different pattern of presentations. So always you have to key note on the past psychiatric history. So we have to, if there is the same pattern, you can say that how long is the person's present and how many episodes they have. Suppose different or pattern of persons, you have to write in detail of the pattern of presentation. For example, now I present with manic symptom, my previous episode is depression. You have to elaborately detail write about the depression symptoms and never forget to write about the past history of treatment. So that's something important for us, because not only it give a clue to our diagnosis, something the past response of the treatment, always we have to prefer to write in the present history, present state. So always use the past history of treatment, always psychiatric treatment. And past history, not only psychiatry, we always include medical as well as surgical histories. Never forget to ask medical history, because not only this give to class, clue to diagnosis, sometimes drug interactions very, very common. During my PG period, one of my PG period, I write lithium. The patient's known hypertension and taking AC inhibitor. But I never forget to ask the AC inhibitor history in my presentation. So next month when he come, he had severe lithium problems. When I ask, then only I go and read what is the reason he taking AC inhibitor, because of the AC inhibitor drug interactions, the lithium level are very high. So I stop the AC inhibitor, ask the physician to stop and change over to some other drug. So always write about the past history or the medical and surgical histories are sometimes important in psychiatric examination. So never forget. And at the same time, in past psychiatric history, you never forget to ask electroconvulsion therapy. Patients sometimes because of the stigma, they never told about ECT especially. So ask specific questions about electroconvulsion therapy if there is manic symptom or depression or suicide histories in our examinations. And family histories, coming to the family history, always you know that three generations, your pedigree chart always useful. But coming to our culture, most of the times our patients not able to describe the maternal side of it. So be specific to ask. And something they're not able to give importance to the genetic loading. So they may not able to tell suicide in my chitappa. He is living in so far from, he doesn't look the patient at all. So that histories I'll always say. So be specific, at least siblings and three generations of that, both maternal and paternal side history to be asked from the patients. So then coming to the personal history, you know that personal histories, another important, forget to say the family history, you always ask for the home environment. Sometimes for anxiety or depressive symptoms, the home environment is more important, because sometimes who dominate the houses, who take decisions. When I become emotionally upset, I go to ventilate. There are so many family intuitive techniques too available, but the PG at least know the home environment, especially if the patients come for any depression or anxiety symptoms. So these are more important families. Coming to the personal history, we always remember that personal history included early childhood, middle and adolescence. But always in psychiatry, we always remember any birth complications to be there. So if the reliable attendant available, you have to ask the birth and birth histories and any history of epilepsy or infections during the neonatal or postnatal periods, and the early childhood, especially for anxiety and other and neurotic symptoms, how the patient, the persons interact with others, whether the shy child, there are that more important in early childhood, and going to the school, when he go to the school, how he separate from the mothers and how he react to the when they he going to the school, separation, anxiety, and other things, and how he interact with the child, how he interact with the others in the peers group, is a shy or able to interact very well, how to interact with the teachers and other things, and how to education. So how to able to cope up with their studies. All these things are in the coming to the important in the school histories. And adolescence period, this period is more important because of our second sexual characteristics and how he handle with that. How he cope up with this and menarche, how he handle the case of the female child, how to handle the menarche and other problems. So these are important in adolescence periods. And coming to the occupations and adulthood and marriage, I will come into later. Occupational history is more important in psychiatry because it's two things important. What is the occupation's current status according to this education level? Suppose I am a BE student, I am working in a driver. Itself indicates some psychopathology in that. And frequent changes of jobs. It's for not for a good reasons. The frequent change of job without any good reasons always indicate you have some psychopathology. So occupational history, you have to give important two things. Either how the occupations, the education status and the occupations and frequent changes of jobs is important to have a psychopathological history and psychosocial history. And for every patients and a female patients come to you, always ask for the menstrual history. Never forget to ask for menstrual history, because in our experiences, in our my PG period, not only asking LMP, because of that only the female, the student can fail. So menstrual history, never forget to ask, and what is the current LMP status, not only because of the pregnant and related status, and the drugs may interact with that. So always remember to the menstrual history and sexual histories. Never forget to ask sexual histories. And always be on our period, we always shy to ask sexual history. Then we are shy and not to able to ask proper questions. So even sexual history, how to ask for another questions, we are always very clear and open to ask sexual histories. And if the married, premarital, extramarital contact, and if there is not married, any self-sexual act, everything to come under this act. Sorry, act. And...